Hey, it's Professor Dave. I want to teach you synthetic division.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We just learned a couple techniques that we can use to solve polynomials. And in doing so, we learned that we can find the factors of polynomials, just like we can find the factors of numbers. When we do prime factorization, we take some number and split it up into factors until we are left with only prime numbers. That begs the question, are there prime polynomials? The answer is yes, and if we have a complex polynomial, it may be prime, meaning it can't be factored, or it could be that we can split it up into a number of different factors. It may not always be easy to tell whether a polynomial can be factored. For example, x to the 6th plus 1 is prime. It can't be factored. But x to the 6th minus 1 is not prime. It can indeed be factored. So we need a way to test whether a polynomial is divisible by a particular expression or not. That technique is called synthetic division. It works a lot like long division, which we learned at the beginning of this course, except that we are using algebraic expressions instead of numbers. This will come in handy if we have something like a cubic or quartic equation, and we know one of the zeros. Let's say we are looking at x to the 4th plus x cubed minus 11x squared minus 5x plus 30, and we want to see if x equals 2 is one of the solutions. If it is, then x minus 2 would be a factor, and that could allow us to simplify the expression. The way we will test this is as follows. Let's make two lines at a right angle like this, and in this top row, we will list only the coefficients of our equation. Then we want to test to see if 2 is one of the solutions, so let's put a 2 to the left over here. Now we take the first coefficient, in this case a 1, and drop it down here. Now we multiply by the 2 and put that here. Now we can add these together to get 3 and write that here. Again, we multiply by 2 to get 6. Adding to negative 11, we get negative 5. Then we multiply to get negative 10, add to get negative 15, multiply to get negative 30, and finally we add to get 0. The fact that this is a zero right here means that there is no remainder from the division, which means that 2 is a solution, and therefore x minus 2 is indeed a factor of this polynomial. These resulting numbers here tell us the coefficients of the polynomial that remains after dividing by x minus 2. We just have to understand that what is left will be of a degree that is one less than the original polynomial. So since we started with a quartic, the result is a cubic. We can simplify this to x minus 2 times x cubed plus 3x squared minus 5x minus 15. If we wanted, we could continue factoring from there until we have nothing but binomials, and therefore all the possible solutions. Say we continue with this one and try to see if negative 3 is a solution. We would perform the same algorithm as before, dropping the 1 down, multiplying to get negative 3, adding to get 0, multiplying to get 0, adding to get negative 5, multiplying to get 15, and adding to get 0. Once again, with a remainder of 0, we see that negative 3 is indeed a solution, and x plus 3 is therefore a factor. So leaving the x minus 2 as it is, we can factor this cubic term further to get x plus 3 times x squared minus 5, which we get from the coefficients we just calculated. That last bit is easy to solve in a separate equation. We just bring 5 over here, take the square root, and we get plus or minus root 5. That means we have successfully found all four solutions to this original quartic equation, and those are 2, negative 3, root 5, and negative root 5. So this is the best way to solve for equations of a degree higher than second degree. You may be wondering, how do we decide which possible solutions to test for? That's a very good question, so let's go over the rational roots test. This is something we can do to get a list of possible solutions to try. To get this list, we just look at the expression, like this one, 2x cubed plus 3x squared minus 3x minus 2, and we make a fraction. On the numerator of this fraction will go all the factors of the constant term, which are 1 and 2. On the denominator go all the factors of the coefficient of the leading term, which are again 1 and 2. We also put a plus or minus to the left of this fraction. To get all the likely zeros to test, we just make all the possible fractions. So we could try plus or minus 1, plus or minus 1 half, and plus or minus 2. That is still 6 possibilities to try, but at least it gives us a short list of good options. Remember, these are not all solutions, just a list of possible solutions. Sometimes, none of these will end up being solutions. It's just a helpful trick that will usually shorten our search. Let's try and see if x equals 1 is a solution. We do our synthetic division by setting things up as we learned before, with the coefficients 2, 3, negative 3, and negative 2. We place the 1 here, drop the first 2 down, and get to multiplying and adding. 1 times 2 is 2. 3 plus 2 is 5. 1 times 5 is 5. Negative 3 plus 5 is 2. 1 times 2 is 2. And negative 2 plus 2 is 0. That means that 1 is indeed a solution. Remember, if this last digit was anything other than 0, then the number you are testing is not a solution. You can cross it out and try something else from the list. But this 1 did work. So we can split up this cubic function into x minus 1, since 1 was a solution, and then a quadratic function given by the coefficients here, which will be 2x squared plus 5x plus 2. From there, we could go back to our list of zeros and try another. Perhaps negative 2 will work. So we can keep the same workspace, put a negative 2 here, drop the 2 down, and off we go. Negative 2 times 2 is negative 4. 5 plus negative 4 is 1. Negative 2 times 1 is negative 2. 2 plus negative 2 is 0. Once again, the 0 means that this is a solution, so we can break this quadratic up into x plus 2, since negative 2 is a solution, and the resulting binomial from synthetic division, 2x plus 1. Looking at this last binomial, it is clear that if we solve this term by itself, we get negative 1 half, and so the three zeros, or solutions, of this cubic are 1, negative 2, and negative 1 half. You can imagine how this can get much trickier for quartics or quintics, especially if the rational roots test gives us a long list of possible zeros to try. But it does give us a rigorous way to solve for these tricky higher degree polynomials, which is indeed an impressive feat. So let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.